We have with us tonight Bruce Lipton, cell biologist and frequent and favorite guest on this show. About a week ago, Bruce and I were chatting, and he mentioned that some of the new data coming in from the Human Genome Project and all that research is confounding the standard scientist, but could be interpreted to support Bruce's thesis that he's been sharing with us for the last decade, and that is that those genes are very malleable, that they actually respond and interact with the environment, I suppose with consciousness as well. And I said, Bruce, stop. Do this on the show. You could spend an hour with me, and I would love that privately, but really everybody wants to hear what you have to say. This is all important research to us all. I'm sure the popular press only shares a part or sometimes often the wrong story. So let's hear it on the show so everyone can hear what you have to say. And tonight's the night. We get to hear Bruce's latest take on that new data coming in and how it actually fits the thesis he's been promoting all along. Welcome back, Bruce.
Thank you very much, Laura.
You know, I only have a sketchy idea of what the Human Genome Project is all about, and perhaps that's where we should begin. Why don't you explain what it is, what it's finding that's confusing the scientist, and then how we can interpret that in the light of your thesis. And I also want to let everyone know that the previous interviews that you've had with us, and they're numerous, are available on our archives and through cassette tape. And you've also got your videos that are very popular that the radio bookstore sells, 800-243-1438, which lays out a lot of your research. Not all of it, because you're adding to it all the time, but lays out a lot of your research. So that's another way to get the full picture of what you have to say. But let's begin with the Human Genome Project for tonight.
Well, it was an exciting adventure. We all planned and heard about it for a number of years. It was about, you know, over a decade in the process. And everybody was like gung-ho to get to the end of the project. Now, we really have to take a step back and say, what is the Human Genome Project? And what was its mission statement? Why did we even invest the billions of dollars to do this? So we start off with the Human Genome Project. It's basically a project where they were extracting the DNA out of a human cell, and then identifying the segments of the DNA that are called genes, and making a compendium, like an index of all the different genes that make up a human. Now, there was a reason behind this. And the reason behind this was not just to do it because it could be done, but the reason behind it was this, and this is where the fun part comes in, because it's like a cosmic joke. It's like a universe humor, I refer to it. That's something like when you could bet the farm and the kitchen sink that it's going to turn left, and with all your awareness and all your knowledge, you know the thing is going to turn left, and just when you make the bet, it turns right. And because it blows you for a loop, because it says somewhere along the line your beliefs were so far off that you didn't even know, you know, you couldn't even understand why it did that. Well, here's the issue. The result of the Human Genome Project, this compendium, turns out to be a cosmic joke.
Okay. Life has that tendency, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. But it's great because it makes us stand up and pay attention to something that we presumed to be a truth, and then find,
keeps the game interesting. Yeah.
So the presumption is simply this: the genes. What are the genes? First of all, the genes are blueprints to make the proteins of the body, and the reason why that's important is that the proteins of the body are the building blocks that give us our behavior and our characteristics and everything that you see about an organism. When you look at it, the character, shape, and behavior and actions are some way related to the protein building blocks. So that knowing the blueprints for the building blocks would help us then say if there was something wrong with one of the organisms, that by changing this building block for another building block, I can make a better or correct the organism's defect, whatever. So the compendium was this belief. In addition to genes that make proteins, there are genes that control the patterns and the unfolding and why we look like a human and a chimp looks like a chimp and a snail looks like a snail, because there are genes that control the patterns, and there are also genes that presumably control the behavior. So the issue is the belief system. Genes are providing the structure and function of the organism, and that you go from more primitive organisms to more complex organisms, you're going to see a change in the genes, and that change could be looked at and understood as to how evolution occurred and how everything is interconnected, how chimps and humans differ, maybe looking for the genes that make us so special. And so basically that was the whole idea. It's just, let's take a look and see if we can find all the pieces and parts that make up the human.
Because that's what humans do. We like to puzzle things out. We like to get to the control switches.
That was the part.
Yeah, so that if we don't like this gene over here, we can change it. If we don't like this behavior over here, we can change it. If we don't like this propensity over here, we can change it. Maybe the computer model was limiting us. We felt that the genes were like a computer model.
I still feel that the genes are actually the programs in place, okay?
But let me make my point.
Yeah.
If we don't like something, go in and rewrite the program, get different results. However, we don't expect a computer program to be interactive and to adapt itself to changes in the environment. So maybe that's where the model is limiting to us.
Yeah, I think basically the model is, there's two aspects of the computer control model that are completely different, and this is where, I think this is the point that you're bringing up, and where science made a mistake. There are two ways to look at a computer-controlled organism. One is say that all the programs are inside the machine. You just push the start button, and the computer program runs the machine, period. And the other process is that it's a computer, but there's a programmer involved, and the programmer and the computer are not the same thing. So basically, conventional thought is, the pharmaceutical industry's belief, of course, that it's a self-contained program, that it's a self-running computer. That's basically what the belief is, okay?
Yeah.
And it turns out that's the whole failure fell apart on this reason. This is where the joke comes in. The complexity of a human is some way related to the fact that we have over 70,000 different proteins, maybe 90,000.
Okay.
There's supposed to be a gene for each protein.
Well, that's kind of like the Chinese language, if there's a character for each word as opposed to characters for letters, and then combinations of letters create words, which is a more elegant system.
Yes.
You just become too hot, top-heavy at one point.
Well, the top-heaviness is, this is what they were trying to explain, why humans are different than snails, is that we are genetically so
top-heavy.
Much more complex to provide for, you know, consciousness and every aspect of human qualities. So the bottom line is that there's 70,000 proteins, or at least maybe 90,000, and then you figure, well, how many genes, you need 70,000 genes just for those proteins, and then you're going to say, well, how many genes do I need to program this beautiful human complexity, and God, 50,000 genes is an average number that's been estimated, but let's just say 30, and the reason why I say that, if I had 30,000 control genes plus 70,000 genes to make the proteins, then what we expect is this, the human genome is going to have a minimum of 100,000 genes. And here was the cosmic joke.
Okay.
There are less than 30,000 genes.
Okay, so a third of the estimated minimum number. So obviously,
not even there.
Obviously the system is more sophisticated and saves space, has a space-saving mechanism.
Absolutely.
Than we thought.
The complexity, just to let you know the relative nature of the complexity, there's a microscopic worm that has been used in a lot of genetic studies because the worm has only 1,029 cells and it has behavior. So by studying the genes, you can study how the anatomy came about and how the behavior in a very small organism.
Right.
This small organism, Cenorhabditis elegans, little tiny, it's microscopic. This worm with 1,029 cells has approximately 20,000 genes.
Okay, so complexity of the number of genes and complexity of the organism aren't related. There's not
if there are 20,000 genes to make this microscopic organism and only 30,000 genes present to make a human, which is so infinitely much more complex, it's more than a third, genes.
So the scale that we had imagined is way off.
Way
Something
off.
Else
it
is going
it
on.
Doesn't work according to what we thought. It's not complexity of genes.
Yep.
And you brought it up. The first part was there are building blocks, and yet the assembly of the building blocks are not controlled by genetic complexity. The assembly of the building blocks that give us our structure, our health, our behavior, is due to the interaction of the genes and the environment. the environment becomes the programmer of the genes, which represent part of, you know, part of the program. The relevant difference is conventional thought said it was self-programmed. Now all of a sudden they recognize there's not enough genes to self-program this machine, that the program is not, the programming is actually in the environment and its interaction with the genes.
So it's a two-way street of communication rather than a one-way street. It's not that the genes dictate to the organism, it's that the organism and the genes have a conversation, a back and forth, a give and take.
To balance their perception of the environment.
That as to adapt
the, as
to the environment.
The environment of an organism, you change the genetic expression of the organism.
There is a famous experiment that we've discussed on the show with other guests who brought this up. They say that there's was a scientist who decided to see how lactose-eating bacteria could adapt to a environment in which there was no lactose, in other words, no food.
Yes, we talked about that before. That's the John Cairns experiment in Nature.
Okay. Let's explain that and demonstrate then that there is an example of the environment speaking to the bacteria, hey, there's no lactose here, and the bacteria responding in just a few generations to adapt themselves to become able to eat the,
yeah,
oh, I got it backwards. The bacteria were lactose intolerant. Then
they
put them in a medium in which,
mutated.
Yeah, then they put them, so they could not digest lactose.
They could use it as a food source, but the only food they gave them to eat was lactose, so
exactly.
They were in a proverbial desert there. There was all this lactose around, but there was not, they couldn't eat it because the gene was mutated. And here's the interesting part, because you said it took generations. It took one generation, once the environment, the organism, which was under stress in the environment, mm-hmm. interacted with the environment and corrected the gene mutation for the lactose in one cell division.
Now, that's a really clear demonstration of the environment and the organism communicating.
Absolutely.
Because you cannot say it was random mutation and the bacteria just happened to hit on mutating to become lactose eating.
But it
you
wasn't
can't
random.
Say that.
It wasn't random.
I know,
that was
you have to
that
throw
was
that
beautiful
one
part
out.
Of the results. It's not random. Here's a beautiful story. Let me add to that experiment. Let me add this experiment. You take five different, you take a source bacterial culture, you break it up into five samples.
Okay.
You put the five different samples into five environments that, the same environments, but the communities are separated from each other. They're in five separate little chambers, so they're not in the same, they're in the same environment, but not communicating.
Got it.
The environment causes them to undergo alterations to survive.
Okay.
Here's the beautiful part, that they all mutated the same in the individual cultures. The results were the same. The end product of the mutation ended up with the bacteria adapting exactly the same. They weren't connected to each other.
So they could not pass genes to one another like the jumping gene theory.
No.
That was prohibited. Okay.
No. And so what it really meant was this, that the environment controlled the evolution so that they would all evolve, come out the same, even though they weren't in communication with each other.
Huh.
So the bottom line says then the mutation process, while there were individual changes in the DNA that were not exactly the same, the net result was the same, that all organisms had to make the same adaptations, change their genes, to conform to survive in the environment. The point being this, if mutation was random, then when you put the bacteria in there, whatever happens is just a case of randomness. But when you show that each colony, even though separated from each other, will mutate exactly the same way, then that our belief that mutation is random and just accident all of a sudden goes out the window, and it says, my God, these organisms were adapting purposely to this environment, that there are actually genetic engineering genes which have now been recognized that allow an organism to adjust its genes to fit the environment that it's in.
Now, isn't that interesting? Because then you can also say maybe they're communicating. Maybe they have a form of telepathy. I know Greg Braden was telling us about a recent experiment in which the DNA, they hooked it up somehow, and they were measuring different response from it, a little DNA in a petri dish, like a skin cell,
uh-huh.
the inner mouth of somebody. And what he was doing up to 50 miles away had an effect on how the DNA was responding. I'm not sure how they hooked everything up.
Baxter's experiments that Cleve was doing with cells that were separated from each other and recording electrical activity.
Yeah, in plants.
In human cells, too.
Yeah.
See, so the bottom line is the belief that we just came into the environment and we are separate from